hand over to this people right here and receiving our prayer spirit this time, Pastor James Hill, as he brings to us as the Lord has given to him. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Because this is the season that you supposedly sent Jesus to be sent for us, or knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. And all that he accomplished makes it possible, Father, today for us to enjoy all that we have received through his sacrificial death. We thank you today that you came that we might have life more abundantly. Yes, not that we loved him, but he loved us. He gave himself to be a sacrifice for our sins. Father, we give you praise and the glory for all that you've done. For you loved us so much until you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We give you praise and the glory now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. And I want to turn to Philippians 2. We're going to read verses 4 through 11. Look not every man on his own things. This is Philippians chapter 2, verses 4 through 11. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. I got one more scripture, 1 John 4. Maybe we can just read scriptures. Amen. 1 John 4:11. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Amen. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Amen. How to place yourself in a position to receive God's mercy, or we could say, God's grace. Amen. We've been speaking about God's willingness to give us the kingdom and all of the blessings that he has provided. He wants us, as the scripture said, he came that we might have life and have life more abundantly. So we learn through all of these teachings that God is not a withholder. God is for us. Everybody just said, God is for me.
God is for me.
He's not against me. He is what?
For me.
Amen. Scripture says that God didn't spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall we not with him freely give us all things? So God is a giver. He's not a withholder. If God wanted to withhold from us, he would have simply just, amen, not let Jesus come. He wouldn't have given up his only son. That's the biggest proof of God's willingness, amen, willingness to bless us, amen, in giving up and relinquishing his only begotten son, amen. And there's a scripture that many of us have read. It says, James 1:5-6, is given to every man liberally, amen. So when you look throughout the scripture, you just have so many scriptures which are so conspicuous, which means that if they just stand out like a sore thumb, that God delighted in mercy. He's looking for the opportunity to pour out his blessings upon us in great abundance. Amen. Bible says he has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. And Psalms 35:27, Psalms 16:19, he daily loadeth us with benefits. Psalms 84:11, he gives grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly before him. Psalms 145:16, he openeth his hand wide and satisfieth the desire of every living thing. Psalms 145:8, full of compassion, slow to anger, of great mercy. So when we began to look throughout the scriptures, we just find scripture after scripture after scripture that let us know that God is a person. Amen. He's not a withholder. He's looking for the opportunity to pour his blessings out upon us in great profusion. Scripture says his eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth. He's looking for the opportunity to bless us. How many believe that God wants to bless you?
Amen.
Amen. He's a good God. Jesus said that I come that you might have what? Life. And that you might have life what? More abundantly. Amen. Brother Williams mentioned this scripture is God's good pleasure. Amen. To be in the kingdom. Somebody that's eager is full of eager yearning. He's looking for the opportunity. He's looking all around, and he's looking for the person whose heart, amen, is open for us. The scripture that we read initially says that God sent Jesus to become the propitiation for our sins. And that scripture that I gave you initially, 2 Corinthians, he kind of puts it all in a nutshell and says this. He said, for we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, grace is God's unmerited favor. Amen. Grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. Amen. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. And Philippians 2 describes how he manifested his love, even how God manifested his love, and how Jesus
became willing to become a sacrifice for our sins. The scripture says that he, when he existed as God, this is from eternity, he existed as God. Amen. And scripture says that he was found in, amen, he took upon him the form of a servant. He made of himself of no reputation and took upon him, this is Philippians 2, and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. So this scripture means, talks about God emptying himself. Jesus emptied himself. In other words, he relinquished all of those virtues and qualities that made him God. He laid them aside. He did not hold on to all of those divine rights and privileges that he experienced, that he enjoyed with the Father from the beginning. But he, amen, took upon him the form of a servant. Amen. So that is some humbling, if you can just kind of imagine Oprah Winfrey. She got a little money, hasn't she? She got a few pennies, a few dollars. Is that right? Can you just imagine her just relinquishing all of her billions and just say, well, I just want to make this sacrifice. I want to cut down. I want to just be a sacrifice. I want to just give away all of my, you know, even all of my wealth so that others throughout the universe can be blessed. I imagine it could go around a pretty good little distance if they would just distribute her well. Amen. Someone said the Waltons were worth, the Waltons, I think there's six or seven of them, is worth as much as one third, they have as much wealth as one third of this entire nation. In other words, they got as much wealth as 93 million Americans. Just six people, it blows your mind. Six people got as much wealth as one third of our country, 93 million Americans. Now, if you can imagine the Waltons and the Oprah giving up all of that, that wouldn't even come close to being what Jesus gave up to come down in the form of a servant. It wouldn't even touch the surface because Jesus gave up everything that was his from eternity. I mean, everything that was made, amen, was belonged to him. Amen. He had power and authority over the works of God's hand. I mean, every virtue, wisdom, knowledge, and all that made him God, he was willing to relinquish all of that and come down in the form of just a regular person. So what I'm saying this morning is that if Jesus did all of this, if God was willing to offer him up so that we, amen, would be able to recapture everything that we lost through Adam's transgression. Amen. Initially, everything that God created was for man, but man lost out when Adam what? Transgressed. When he sinned, he lost out. So this was an effort for God to recapture, and through being in Christ, receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and really begin and really understanding your rights and privileges as believers, you would be able to recapture all that you lost out on in Adam. That's the reason why the scripture says all things are yours. Bible says he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places through Christ Jesus, right?
Amen.
Amen. He's given us everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. So everything that pertains to life and godliness, amen, has become legally ours again. And if we can release faith and place ourselves in a position to take advantage of these benefits and blessings, then these things will become ours in reality. Amen. That's good news. Jesus said that I am come that you might have what? Life, and that you might have life what? More abundantly. So the dispensation of grace is designed, amen, to enable God to open up a bigger door. Although in the old, under the old covenant, men were blessed. The seven redemptive names of Jehovah were the way that God had to reveal to us the entire scope of blessings that he had provided us through Christ, even before Christ gave his life. Amen. Those were blessings that we could draw on even before Christ died. It was something like a promissory note. All those, Christ hadn't died under the old covenant, but provisions for his death had already been what? Made. And God enabled us to draw from those blessings and benefits even before, amen, the redemptive process was consummated. Amen. Isn't God good?
Amen.
Isn't God good? The Bible says, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his what? Goodness. And his what? Wonderful works. How many know God's works are wonderful? Amen. We don't act like that this morning. We're just looking around. We're looking at how bad things are. Amen. The Bible says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord for his good and his what? Mercy. Endureth forever. And it said, let the redeemer of the Lord what? Say so. Amen. I think that we ought to be in the business of not complaining, whipping and whining, looking around, see what we ain't got. What ain't going right. Amen. But the Bible says that the redeemer of the Lord what? Say what is going right. What God has done. I think it will lift you up to a higher level if you would just focus on what God has done. Amen. And get your mind off of what the devil has what? Amen. Has what? Done. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus came that we might have what? Life. The enemy came to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said that I am come that you might have what? Life, and that you might have life what? More. How many believe that God wants you to have abundant life? Amen. How many believe that God is trying to give the blessings to you? He's not trying to what? Get them, amen, out or amen, from you. He's not trying to take them away. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said that I am come that you might have what? Life. And that you might have life more abundantly. Well, you know, since all of these blessings are mine, and amen, since he came that we might have life and life more abundantly, amen, if all things are mine and he has given us everything, why aren't we enjoying the abundance of blessings and benefits that has already been what placed in our possession? Legally. Amen. I'm going to start right here. I'm going to give you one instant, and we're going to let you determine the reason why many of these blessings are not getting to us. All right, I want you to turn to this scripture here. I want you to turn to Job. We've already studied this. I wanted to make sure that I did something that was familiar because, amen, on Christmas, I didn't want you to puzzle your brains too much. Amen. You got too much to think about. Amen. Job 42. And I want you to turn to that particular scripture. Job 42, it says, I'm going to start with the 42nd verse. Hallelujah. 42nd chapter, and I'm going to start with the first verse. Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that thou canst do everything, and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Amen. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered, that I understood not, things too wonderful for me, which I knew not. Here I beseech thee, and I will speak, I will demand of thee, and declare thou unto me. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eyes seeth thee. Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. Amen. I just want you to see the Bible mentions about Job. He went through a whole lot of catastrophic things. Amen. Very, very severe losses. The loss of his what? His possession. He was the richest man of the East. The Bible says he was a perfect and upright man. But he lost all of his possessions. How many would probably have some serious problems if you lost all the little bit you do have that you worked so hard for? Anybody? Amen. All right? Got one or two. So you have never had a big loss. If you had a big loss, you probably could relate more. All right, but Job lost his family, his possessions, his health, and he became just a shadow of what he was in the past. He had great respect, great friends. He had everything going for him, but he lost everything, even the respect of his friends and his acquaintances. Amen. So Job and his friends were arguing, they were bickering, and they were in serious conflict with each other. Because Job was justifying himself. He said, ain't nothing that I did that have caused all of this to come upon me. But his friend said, Job, you just lying. You are the biggest sinner in town. I mean, you have to have done something real bad for all of these terrible things to come upon you. So Job and his friends, amen, they were just going back and forth accusing each other. So it came to a point, amen, where God had to step in. And Job was the person that we are addressing here. Amen. So when Job came to the end of himself, and he really began to see himself as God sees him, and Job began to acknowledge, amen, the part that he had to play, amen, that he played in his what? Loss. Because Job was at fault to some degree. Job, the Bible says, the thing that he greatly feared, amen, came upon him. So it was fear. It was him lifting himself up, trying to justify, amen, himself before God and making himself appear more holy and righteous than he should have. So he crossed the line. And he got lifted up in pride, trying to justify himself and to defend himself, amen, concerning those things that he had experienced. The Bible says that when Job was convinced by the Lord that he had erred, that he had deviated from God's way, the Bible says Job repented in dust and ashes. Amen. Now, verse 7, and it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against thee, and against my two friends, for ye have not spoken of me the things that is right as my servant Job had. Therefore, take unto you now 7 bullocks and 7 rams. Go to thy servant Job and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you. For him will I accept, lest I deal. See, Job got himself straight. He repented. He got himself in lines for the blessings of God to come upon him. Amen. So you want to always place yourself in a position where God's grace can what? Reach you. Amen. For him will I accept, lest I deal with you after your folly, in that ye have not spoken of me the things which is right, like my servant Job. Amen. So Eliphaz and the Temanite and Bildad the Shuhite and Zophar and Naam Hathite went and did according as the Lord commanded them. The Lord also accepted Job. Verse 10 is the scripture I want to get to. The Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then came there unto him all of his brethren and all of his sisters and all they that had been of his acquaintance before, and did eat bread with him in his house. And they bemoaned him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also gave him a piece of money, and every one an earring of gold. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning, for he had 14,000 sheep and 6,000 camels and 1,000 yoke of oxen and 1,000 she-ass. He had also 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he called the name of the first, so forth. Verse 15, and in all of the land were no woman found so fair as the daughters of Job, and their father gave them inheritance among their brethren. And this lived Job and 40 years and saw his sons and his sons' sons, even four generations. So Job died being old and full of days. So you can see the thing that turned the captivity of Job when Job what? Forgave his friends. Job turned around and what? Prayed for his friends. Amen. He got rid of that, all of that animosity, that hatred, that all of that conflict and mess that he was accusing his friends of. And when Job rolled all of his hurts and frustrations and pains and disease and cares on the Lord, amen, Job received mercy. He received mercy. Boy, 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 amen. And God gave him glory. He turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. So God promised blessings to the merciful. Amen. Psalms 18:25. With the merciful, thou wilt show thyself merciful. With the upright man, thou wilt show thyself upright. Matthew 7:7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall what? Obtain mercy. Amen. So you can see in this particular passage that when a person humbles themselves before the Lord and submit to God's way, amen, the Bible says God resists the proud, but he gives what? Grace to those that will what? Humble themselves. See, Job, amen, came to the end of himself, and he realized that he had what? Done wrong, and he what? Repented. And that's the reason why Jesus said, repent and believe. Repent and what? Believe. The blessings, amen, are not going to be able to be released. God can't release blessings in your life unless there is an attitude of what? Faith. Amen. Bible says that if iniquity abound, amen, God does not hear what sinners pray, but in every nation he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Amen. And there's another scripture that says that, amen, that if iniquity, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not what? Hear me. So the prerequisite for receiving God's grace is that you got to have what? A clean heart. You got to have what? You got to get stuff right. You got to what? Be in fellowship, amen, with God. How many can say amen? Amen. How many can say amen, even amen on Christmas morning? Amen. See, faith is the union of our hearts and wills with God's will and purpose. And where this unity is lacking, results are impossible. This is a very important spiritual law to which in our time we have been woefully blind. See, many times we don't understand the relationship between faith and our right standing with God. So we have to, amen, praise God, acknowledge the fact that God resists the proud, but he gives what? Grace to the humble. How many want to be in that position where the grace of God can reach you? How many can say amen? So that's the first virtue that we have to keep in mind when we want to receive from God. God resists the what? Proud. But he gives what? Gives what? Grace. Amen. He gives grace to the humble. Amen. Praise God. I want you to write that down today. Scripture says, Proverbs 22:4, by humility and the fear of the Lord, those are two qualities that God is looking for. Scripture says his eyes are what? Running to and fro. You know, God has too many blessings for us just to, amen, amen, try to approach him in any kind of way. And we have too much to lose. We have too much to miss out on. Amen. We want to place ourselves, amen, in a position, in a place where God's grace can what? Where God's grace can reach us. I believe that there's a grace for every problem, every challenge, every crisis, everything that you're going for through. There's a grace. God has grace. Scripture says his grace is what? Sufficient. Amen. His grace is what? Sufficient. And he's able to cause what? All grace. Amen. How many believe that God got enough grace for whatever you're dealing with? He's got more than enough.
Bible says he's able to keep that which he has committed into your hands. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can what? Think or ask, according to the power that worketh in you. And I'm going to keep myself in the, amen, in the place where God's grace can what? Reach me. Amen. If I regard iniquity in my heart, God won't even what? He won't even hear me. So you want to make sure that you are not a withholder, because what? God is what? Is not a withholder. Amen. I gave you this scripture last week. Some of you don't want to hear this again. Turn to Proverbs 3:27. Amen. So this is, many times we withhold from people that which is due. Amen. That's within, you know, that is within the power of your hand to do. Okay, I want somebody to read that scripture, Proverbs 3:27 again. See, Job could have said, no, them dirty low-down dogs, man, they talked about me, they raped me over cold, they accused me of all of these things that I went through, and, you know, and I wasn't guilty of them. He could have taken that attitude, said, I'm not going to pray for not either one of them stinking dogs. He could have taken that attitude, but Job was what? He was very merciful. Amen. And that scripture said, do not withhold good. Alright. Do not withhold what? Good. From them to whom it is due when it's in the power of your hand to do it. Amen. So God is not a what? He's not a withholder. And that's the reason why people that withhold from God, amen. See, God, you're on one page and God is on another page. Bible said, he has pleasure. Ooh, glory. Know the thing, the Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives what? Grace and glory. Know the thing. Hallelujah. Will he withhold from them that walk upright before him? All right. See, God, amen, he's not a withholder. So if you're withholding your praise, your worship, your money, or whatever it is, boy, God can't work in that type of environment. Amen. It's getting quiet now. All right. So the scripture says in Proverbs 11, Sister Hill, let's see if you can find that scripture. Proverbs, I believe it is 11. And it mentions about the reason why many times God's blessings can't reach us because we are withholding. Proverbs 11:24. Proverbs 11. See, the thing that's dearest to all of our hearts and the thing that we have a tendency to withhold more than any other area, amen, is the area of our finances. So I'm not expecting anybody to say amen on that. But this is Christmas and I know what we've done with our money. All right, Proverbs 11:24, is that right?
Yes, there is that.
So, all right, there is that. That's what?
Scattering. Mm-hmm. And yet increase. And there is that withholdeth more than is meet, but it tendeth to poverty.
Okay, there is the person that just keep on giving. So this is Christmas season. Amen. It's not about all the presents you're going to get. Amen. It's about what? It's not you wanting to receive everything. But I think it should be more about what? Those around you. Jesus came to what? Amen. That we might have what? Life. Life more what? Abundantly. See, some people will just give. Just give. They have a liberal heart. The Bible says the liberal soul shall be the what? Made fat. How many are liberal? Alright. So, there are some people, the more they give, the more they what? The more they have. How does that work? That sounds funny, doesn't it? The more you give away, the more you get. Does that sound rational to the average person? No. The average person say, well, I ain't no fool. I know we supposed to bring them tithe and offerings. I shouldn't be talking about tithe and offerings on Christmas. Amen. Even though some of the tithe and offering might be tied up in that turkey dinner. Amen. But the Bible says that he that soweth sparingly
shall what? Reap sparingly, but he that soweth what? Bountifully. God loveth a what? Cheerful giver. And he's like, woo, glory. See, if you are a giver, there's he that scattereth. Amen. Abroad, praise God, but yet he's going to what? Increase. But there's a person that holds on. Amen. He holds, and that tended to what? Poverty. Amen. I've never seen a person that holds on. Holds on. Holds on. Amen. It seems like we never can get to the point where we can trust God for our finances like we're trusting him for our what? Our souls. Amen. And leads to what? Poverty. Bible said there's an evil that I have seen under the sun, namely what? Riches, which the owner, I believe that so evil I've seen under the sun, namely riches, which, amen, the owner does to his own hurt. That's Ecclesiastes 5:13. I've got one more side. We just want you to get in the spirit of giving, because it's not by what you can receive. You know, Hambone says, receiving is good enough for me. That's the Bible. Jesus came that we might have what? Life. Not that we loved him, but he loved us, and he gave himself a what? Perpetuation. Now, when you compare what Jesus gave for us in order that we might have life, amen, I think that it ought to challenge you. The Bible says, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life, amen, for us. Perceive ye the love of God. Look at the love of God. Perceive ye the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And if he laid down his life for us, we ought to be willing to lay down our lives for our brother. We ought to be willing to lay down. Amen. Your tithe. And that which Bible says, don't withhold that which is what? Withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it's in the power of your hand to do it. Amen. So we don't want to be withholders. Touch somebody and say, I'm not going to be no withholder. Amen. Oh, yada bahashata. Well, that was sure quiet. Y'all did it secretly almost, didn't you? Undercover. I don't want the devil to hear me on this one. All right. Ecclesiastes 5:13, you have that? There's a soul evil, amen, going out of this year into next year. We want to begin to, okay, there is an evil I have seen under the sun, namely riches. All right, kept for the owner thereof to their hurt. All right, y'all look at that? There's an evil. God says that it's an what? Evil. Sore evil. That means a what? I agree with you. God hates selfishness. This is Christmas time. It's a time that we ought to be what? Giving. How many believe that we ought to be having a spirit of giving? Amen. How many know that all the preparation that we've done has been centered around what? Us. Our families. Amen. Many times the plan of God hasn't been included. Okay, let's finish that up so we can go further. That's okay. So evil, I blame under the sun. Namely, riches kept for the owner to their own hurt. Now, the other scripture I want to just mention, 1 Timothy 6:10. Leave it for me, and then I'm going to get on something good where I can get some positive responses. Jesus said that if he perceived the love of God, if he laid down his life for us, we ought to be willing to lay down our last life of what? Brother. Somebody said we ought to be willing to lay down our lives. We ought to be willing to lay down our lives. You know, the way that we can help our brother and most is to contribute whatever we can to enhance him spiritually. You know, I'm not talking about going and getting a whole lot of tangible things. Whatever we can do in the kingdom of God that can enhance one another. I don't think it's fair for us to what? Amen. Leave all the responsibility of spiritual development and spiritual nurturing and amen, all of that to others. In other words, I don't think it's fair for us not to assume our responsibility And just like the heat, I came here this morning around 7 o'clock. I was just thinking, man, suppose we didn't have heat. And the saints are supposed to be here at 9 o'clock. But who pays for all of this? Who pays for all of that? Amen. Somebody has to pay. Amen. That means that what? Those that will what? Those that contribute faithfully. So we're really concerned about going into a new year with the right attitude. All right. God resists the proud, but he gives what? All right. 1 Timothy 6:10. All right.
They have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows.
All right. The love of money is the root of all evil.